Welcome everyone to Elul's Mon at Drusha. We once again have the pleasure of learning with Dr. Gaffney. Today's class is a continuation of our Elul series. It is called Malchuyot, Zichronot, and Shofarot.
Okay, thank you so much. I'm going to share my screen now and then we'll start. So just one second. You see my screen?
You are starting to share, and now I can see your screen.
Okay, so today we're going to continue with our discussion of different tefillot, different prayers of Yamim Noraim, and perhaps today we're going to address the highlight of the Yamim Noraim in some way, the tefillah of Musaf of Rosh Hashanah, and more specifically the part of the Malchuyot, Zichronot Shofarot, which is maybe the centerpiece of Tfilat Musaf of Yamim Noraim. And again, we're not going to discuss traditional observations only, but also the ways that scholars, modern scholars, suggest to view these brachot, these blessings, some of the new insights of scholars in the last 50 years or so. Needless to say, every observation or every new insight is always a matter of debate, and different scholars have different opinions about everything. But nevertheless, I think it's important for us to think about those ideas. And they also make us, I think, when you say the tefillot just a few days from now, I think it gives it an extra meaning, or you think about it in a different way. Okay, so as I said, we're going to discuss today Malchuyot, Zichronot, Shofarot. And what I said, the way I described them, is one of the center parts of, or the centerpieces of Yamim Noraim. And it's not just my recommendation or my feeling. This is already something that Rabbi Akiva in the Talmud expresses. This is from a sugya in Masechet Rosh Hashanah, in Tractate Rosh Hashanah, but it also appears in other parallel texts. The Gemara says as follows, Amar Rabbi Yehuda Mishum Rabbi Akiva. So Rabbi Judah says in the name of Rabbi Akiva, and I skipped a few lines here, but then he reaches Rosh Hashanah. He gave other recommendations for other stuff. And then he says, Imru lefanai, this is what God is telling us, Imru lefanai b'Rosh Hashanah, Malchuyot, Zichronot, Shofarot. Also recite before me on New Year, texts mentioning, making mention of kingship, remembrance, and the Shofar, kingship. Why? Malchuyot, and the Shofar, Malchuyot, kingship, why? So that you may proclaim me king over you. Kedei shetamlichuni alichem. Zichronot, the remembrance, so that kedei sheyale zichronchem lefanai letova, so that your remembrance may rise favorably before me. Uvameh, and through what? Through the shofar. So Rabbi Akiva recommended us to take this seriously. And indeed, that was what we're going to do. We're going to discuss Malchuyot, Zichronot, Shofarot. This text, by the way, has other parallels that are slightly different in the way they're formulated. For instance, here it's God's words telling us, this is what you should say or recite before me. In other versions, it's Rabbi Akiva speaking, Imru lefanav, you shall tell him the following passages. Either way, it's a center part of the tefillah. So what are we going to discuss today? We're gonna discuss a few questions that are have to do with the Malchuyot, Zichronot, Shofarot. The first question we're going to discuss is something about the origins of Malchuyot, Zichronot, Shofarot. Who instituted these blessings? Where are they coming from? That's the first thing we're going to discuss. The second theme we're going to discuss is the way that these brachot, these blessings, were integrated in our tefillah, the way that the Talmud suggests we are supposed to say it, and the way it ended up in our current Nusachei Tfilah, in our current Sidurim. So that's the second theme, something more of structure. The third theme we're gonna talk about is the order of the verses, because if you all remember, I'm sure you remember, that the verses in the Malchuyot, Zichronot, Shofarot is a little bit awkward. It doesn't follow the usual order of Torah, Nevi'im, Ktuvim, but rather Torah, Ktuvim, and only at the end we say the Nevi'im. So the third question we're going to discuss, why are the verses out of order? And finally, so it won't be just about, not just critical insights about this, we'll try to say something also about the message, or one of the messages that these blessings are teaching us, or something that we can learn from the Malchuyot, Zichronot, and Shofarot. Just one small point that I find interesting. Okay, so we're starting with the first with the number one, the origins of Malchuyot, Zichonot, and Shofarot. If we had to guess which of these Malchuyot, Zichonot, and Shofarot has more to do with Rosh Hashanah, I think it would be obvious for us that Zichonot and Shofarot have a very natural connection to Rosh Hashanah, and we can understand how they came up and why did people recommend saying verses that have to do with Zichonot and Shofarot. And why is that? Because the Torah in Vayikra, Kaf Gimel Dalet says, and this is pretty much all we know about Rosh Hashanah from the Torah, not much more than this, it says, Daber el bnei Yisrael lemor, בחודש השביעי באחד לחודש, יהיה לכם שבתון, זיכרון, תרועה, מקרא קודש. Or in English, speak unto the children of Israel, saying the seventh month, the first day of the month, shall you have a Shabbat, a memorial of blowing trumpets, a holy convocation, which means זיכרון and תרועה are actually mentioned in the verse explicitly, and therefore it's not surprising that זיכרונות and שופרות will become something very meaningful and very important in the tefillah, in the prayers of Rosh Hashanah. And indeed, this is the source that the Tanaim bring when they're trying to support or ground the need to recite verses of Zichronot and Shofarot in the tefillah. In the Tosefta, and again, we have other parallels for this text, it says as follows. I didn't bring it in English because it's pretty straightforward. Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Rabbi Eliezer, Shabbaton zo kedushat hayom, Zichron, elu zichronot, tru'a elu shofarot, mikra kodesh kadshehu. So we don't need to discuss now the Shabbaton part or the mikra kodesh part, but he's deriving from the words zichron tru'a that we're supposed to say both zichronot and shofarot. Rabbi Akiva has some other observations about the verse there. He argues about the words Shabbaton and mikra kodesh, but nevertheless he agrees that zichron elu zichronot and tru'a elu shofarot. So the obvious parts, zichronot and shofarot, can easily be linked or tied to the verses that speak about Rosh Hashanah. The more problematic one is the part of Malchuyot. Where is Malchuyot mentioned in the Torah in the context of Rosh Hashanah or in general? We don't have any place where the Torah emphasizes this, certainly not in the context of Rosh Hashanah. Indeed, when the Gemara or the Tanaim and later on the Amoraim discuss Malchuyot, they're providing us sources that are really not as obvious as the ones of Zichronot and of Shofarot. What type of sources? I brought one of a few. It's not the only opinion, but all opinions are not really very convincing. Just one example, the Gemara suggests, how do we know, or what do we know that we say Malchuyot? Because we have here something that is Chazal referred to as smichut parshiot, the proximity of two parshiot, two paragraphs that come one after the other. The passage in Sefer Vayikra, before the one that discusses Rosh Hashanah, is the one of Shavuos, and it ends with the words Ani Hashem Elohechem, and immediately afterwards, almost immediately afterwards, we start with Rosh Hashanah, discussing B'chodesh Hashevi'i Be'echad LaChodesh. So some of the rabbis suggest perhaps this smichut or proximity between these two parshiot, perhaps that was the reason that we say Malchuyot, because it kind of connects the idea of Ani Hashem Elohechem, I am your king, to the idea of B'chodesh Hashvi'i Be'echad LaChodesh. And this is what one of the Tanaim says. So as you see the verses here in English, the Shavuos one ends with the words I am your God, and the Rosh Hashanah starts with the words in the seventh month on the first day. And one of the Tanaim actually says that Rabbi says, Minayin shomrim malchuyot, Tanya, Tanaitic source, Rabbi Omer, Ani Hashem Elohechem, uvachodesh hashvi'i, zo malchut. In English, whence then do we know that we're supposed to say the kingship verses? It has been taught, Rabbi says, I am the Lord your God, and immediately afterwards in the seventh month. This indicates kingship verses. So this is the source for Malchuyot, and I think that you already feel now that the Malchuyot don't have such solid foundations in the text. But I think it even goes beyond that. There's other reasons to think that Malchuyot are not really rooted so strongly in the verses, because the Zichronot and the Shofarot appear elsewhere in other contexts of halakha without malchuyot, again indicating that they have more solid foundations in the text, whereas malchuyot seems to be a little bit more shaky. What am I alluding to? What sources am I referring to? So malchuyot and zichonot also appear in Masechet Ta'anit. Maybe it's a surprise for you. I was surprised to see it for the first time. I thought zichonot, shafarot are only connected to Rosh Hashanah, but they actually appear also in the Mishnah, in Masechet Ta'anit. The Mishnah discusses times when there was no rain, and at some point, people used to start fasting, having all sort of sets of fast days, but also special prayers. And the Mishnah says as follows. I'll bring the text both in English and in Hebrew. So the Mishnah says as follows. Amdu batfila, they stand to pray. Moridim lifnei ha-teiva, zaken v'ragil. We bring in front of the ark an elderly man who is a regular, who's familiar with doing this praying job, being a shliach tzibur. Ve'omer lifnehem 24 brachot. And he says before them 24 blessings. What are they? He says the regular routine 18 blessings of Shmone Esre, because we're talking about a weekday now. And he adds an additional six brachot, six blessings. And the first two are zichronot and shofarot. So he says the 18 that we say every day and adds upon them another six. And the first two, and they are these, the remembrance or zichronot and the shofarot. So here too, we see zichronot and shofarot seem to have more solid foundations in halakha, and malchuyot seems a bit more shaky. It's biblical sources, and even in rabbinic sources, seem a little bit more shaky. So the first insight I wanted to share with you, insight of modern scholars, is that perhaps what many scholars suggested about 100 years ago and onwards, many scholars suggested that perhaps the idea of malchuyot in Rosh Hashanah is actually a later invention. We often think that malchuyot, or appointing or anointing God as the king of the world, is the main theme of Rosh Hashanah. It's the main essence of this day. But perhaps the idea of malchuyot only came into the picture a little later. So when did it come into the picture? Who was the person who initiated or suggested this idea that Rosh Hashanah is about malchuyot? And why? Why did he suddenly suggest this? So historians suggested that perhaps it was actually not an ancient idea, but only a second century idea that is affiliated or associated with the sage that actually recommended reciting all these verses. And I'm reminding you again, it was Rabbi Akiva. If you see here again, Rabbi Akiva is the sage, the Tana, who comes and says, you should say the blessings of Malchuyot. Many scholars therefore suggest it was maybe only a second century invention or idea that Malchuyot will become such a significant element in Rosh Hashanah. And why Rabbi Akiva? Why would it be Rabbi Akiva? Why would Rabbi Akiva be so passionate about this idea? So you can guess, if we know the biography of Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Akiva is a big opponent of the Roman Empire. Specifically at the time of the Bar Kokhba revolt, when Jews are rebelling against Adrian. And many, many scholars suggest that perhaps this is part of the inspiration, emphasizing we worship God. We're not worship any idol or any Caesar, such as Adrian. I'm giving you just one example. One of the scholars who pointed this idea, Louis Finkelstein, says similarly, the preparation for the Bar Kokhba rebellion brought about the re-emphasis on the conception of divine kingdom. And he brings Rabbi Akiva as evidence for this. Thus, Rabbi Akiva is said to have established the prayer of Avinu Malkeinu. We'll talk about this in a second. And he goes on, I'm skipping. Professor Louis Ginsberg had definitely proved that the Malchuyot were inserted in the prayer for Rosh Hashanah in the time of Rabbi Akiva. So perhaps what we think as such an essential idea or a cornerstone of Rosh Hashanah, the idea of the Malchut of God, Malchut Hashem, that we do on Rosh Hashanah, perhaps it's actually a later invention. Both of these scholars provided a very beautiful proof for this from Masechet Ta'anit. The Gemara over there tells the following story. We're talking about days of drought, no rain. And this is what the Talmud tells, the story. Ma'aseh b'Rabbi Eliezer, she'arad ifnei ha'tiva. There was another incident involving Rabbi Eliezer, who descended to serve as prayer leader before the Ark on a fast day. Ve'amar 24 brachot ve'lo na'ana. He said 24 brachot, meaning the ones that are mentioned in Masechet Ta'anit, but he was not answered. He recited, but his prayers were not answered. So then what follows is, Yarad Rabbi Akiva. So Rabbi Akiva descended before the Ark. Ve'amar, so he came afterwards and said the following words, Avinu Malkeinu, En lanu melech el ata, Avinu Malkeinu lema'ancha rachem aleinu v'yarduk shamim. So we see, we have a prayer that included the zichronot and the shofarot, and that did not include the malchuyot, and that was not answered at that particular case. Rabbi Akiva comes and adds this idea of malchut Hashem ba'olam, that we're supposed to emphasize the role of God as our king. As based on this source and on other sources as well, it's not the only source, scholars suggested malchuyot perhaps is a later element and not an original element in the days of Rosh Hashanah. Another proof for this theory is also found in the next theme we're going to discuss, and that is the way that Birkat Malchuyot, the blessing of Malchuyot, was integrated in the Tfilah of Rosh Hashanah, in the Musaf of Rosh Hashanah. And this is going to be our next theme. We're going to talk about the way that the Brachot, are, the order of the Brachot, and the way that you're supposed to recite them as part of Musaf, and how it also made its way into our current Sidurim. So this is going to be the second theme we're going to discuss today. So let's look at the Mishnah. So we're moving from the origin of Malchuyot, Zichonot, Veshofarot to this next theme, which is the order and the way that we're supposed to say the Brachot in the Tfilah. So we have a machloket, we have a debate on this matter between two Tanaim in the Mishnah in Tractate Rosh Hashanah. As a matter of fact, this is the first time that Malchuyot, Zichronot, and Shofarot appear in the Mishnah, in the context of Rosh Hashanah. So let's see what the two Tanaim say. We're going to talk about Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri, a rabbi from the Galilee, and the other one is Rabbi Akiva. And we will see what each one of those Tanaim think about the order of the Brachot. And this is how it goes. So the Mishnah says as follows. Seder Brachot. The order of the brachot, meaning the order of the blessings, in the tefillat Amidah, the Shmonesra that we say. So how does it go? Omer Avot. So you start by saying the bracha of Avot, meaning the bracha that we end with the words. We start Elohe Avraham, Elohe Yitzchak, Elohe Yaakov. That's why it's called Avot. That ends with the words Magen Avraham. So that's the first bracha. Then he follows Gvurot, the bracha of Mechaya Meitim, Ata Gibor. Blah, 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 Mechayam Itim. So that's the second bracha. And then, this is the crucial part. According to Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri, the third bracha is Kedushat Hashem. You say the bracha that starts with the words Ata Kadosh, and so on. Vecholel Malchuyot Imahen. You're supposed to integrate the bracha of Malchuyot as part of the third bracha of Shmones, of Kedushat Hashem. The bracha that ends with the word, that starts with the words Ata Kadosh, Veshimcha Kadosh. So in that bracha, you're supposed to include the Malchuyot. And he does not blow the shofar so at this point. Ve'ino toke. Only later he goes and he says, Kedushat Hayom, the bracha that talks about the importance of the day or the holiness of the day. It starts with the words, Ata b'chartanu, talking about the importance of the day. And then you do the first blowing of the shofar, Zichronot, and you blow the shofar. Shofarot v'tokea, and then you conclude with the regular parts of Shmone Esre, Avodah, which means Retzeh, v'techezena einenu, Avodah v'et ha-mikdash, Hoda'ah is Nemodim, u'birkat Kohanim, which is the way they refer to the bracha of Sim Shalom. So we start Avod, Gvurot, and Kedushat Hashem like every day. We end with Avodah, Hoda'ah, v'birkat Kohanim like every day. In the middle, we have Kedushat Hayom, Zichronot v'Shofarot, and the Malchuyot are integrated as part of the third bracha of Shmone Esra, Kedushat Hashem. That's the opinion of Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri. Rabbi Akiva argues, Amar lo Rabbi Akiva, according to the way you put it, in the when we say the Malchuyot, we're not supposed to blow the shofar because it's part of the third bracha, and Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri said that the third bracha still does not include the tkiot. So Rabbi Akiva asks him, Im eino tokea, Amar lo Rabbi Akiva, Im eino tokea le Malchuyot, lama hu mazkir? if he does not sound the shofar for the blessing of kingship of Malchuyot, why bother mentioning altogether? And therefore he concludes, Ela, rather, you're supposed, he says, Omer Avot Ugvurot Vekdushat Hashem. So he starts with saying Avot Gvurot Vekdushat Hashem, like every day. However, Kolel Malchuyot in Kdushat Hayom. The Malchuyot are only included in the fourth blessing of Shmoneh, so the one that starts with the words Ata Bechartanu Mikol Amim, talking about the importance of the day. And then you already do the Tkiah, Zichronot Vetokea, Shofarot Vetokea, Veomer Avodah Veodah Birkat Kohanim. So you include the Malchuyot as part of the fourth bracha rather than the third bracha, and with the Tkiot Shofar, and then you continue to the Zichronot and to the Shofarot. To simplify, I hope it simplifies this thing for you, so I put it in this chart, and you can see that essentially Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri and Rabbi Akiva agree about most of the basic structure of Shmoneh Esrei. They agree that the order of the brachot is the same, more or less. It will have Avot, Gvurot, Kedushat Hashem, Kedushat Hayom, Zichronot, Shofarot, Avodah, Hoda'ah, V'Shalom. That part they agree. We have 9 brachot altogether, and the content of that part of Shmoneh Esrei is the same. They also agree that the shofar blowing is done in the middle 3 brachot of the Shmoneh Esrei. So we say 3 brachot without the tkiot, 3 brachot at the end without tkiot, in the middle we have the tkiot shofar. The only thing that they argue about is where do we locate the malchuyot? Are we locating them with the part that goes with the kedushat Hashem, meaning in the third bracha of Shmoneh Esrei? Or perhaps we're supposed to include them in the fourth bracha of Kedushat Hayom. Rabbi Akiva says that he doesn't believe you should say the Malchuyot if you're not blowing the shofar, and therefore he believes we're supposed to move them one bracha ahead to the fourth bracha. So the first thing I want to mention, this is still ending the first theme that we said, I think the very fact that they're arguing where to place Malchuyot, are you supposed to place it in the third bracha or the fourth bracha, is another indication that this bracha had a shaky status, that it was not the an original part or an original element of Shmoneh Esrei. If it was an original bracha, if it was from the very beginning, we would not expect different sages to argue where it belongs, fourth, or third. We would assume that it should deserve its own bracha, just like Zichronot and Shofarot. The very fact that this bracha was the location where we're supposed to include that bracha was something that was a matter of debate, perhaps gives us another indication that the status of Malchuyot may have been a new invention that came up only later on. And that's why different sages are arguing where is the proper place to include it. So this is still connecting to what we've said before. But what I want to address now is another question. And that is, how did it end up in our current Sidurim? So what do we say nowadays? Do we follow the approach of Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri, or do we follow the approach of Rabbi Akiva? Okay, so how do we do it? Before we look into the Sidur, I want to check in the Poskim. Let's see what the Poske Halacha say. And I included here, I could have brought many. I just brought you here the Rambam and the Tur to see how they're Posek, how they determine the Halacha in this particular case. And I think you will immediately see that they're very clear about this. Rambam, in Hilchot Shofar, Vesuka Verulav, but we're dealing with the Shofar now, says, I'll start with the Hebrew, Hatzibur Chayavim Lishmoa Hatkiot Al Seder HaBrachot. Heitzad, so you're supposed to say the Tkiot along with the Brachot. And how does that work? Omer Shliach Tzibur Avot Ugvurot Ukdushat Hashem ומלכויות ותוקיה שלוש, ואומר זיכרונות ותוקיה שלוש, ואומר שופרות ותוקיה שלוש, ואומר עבודה והודיה וברכת כהנים. I'll read this in English as well. The Chazan recites avot, גבורות, the sanctification of God's name, קדושת השם, and then מלכויות, the shofar is sounded 3 times, זיכרונות, the shofar is sounded 3 times, שופרות, the shofar is sounded 3 times, and avodah, acknowledgement, or hoda'ah, and the priestly blessing, which is Birkat HaShalom. I think it becomes very clear that Rambam was following the halacha of Rabbi Akiva, meaning you're supposed to say the first brachot without any additions and without blowing the shofar. it is only the fourth bracha that you include the malchuyot with the blowing of the shofar. The only thing that is a little bit puzzling about the Rambam is that for some reason or another, he doesn't emphasize that malchuyot are included in Kedushat Hayom. He just says, malchuyot v'tokea shalosh. You're supposed to blow the shofar while you're saying malchuyot. But from the Mishnah, it's pretty clear that he's following Rabbi Akiva, because that was the whole point Rabbi Akiva was trying to make. Why bother saying malchuyot if you're not blowing the shofar in the third bracha? Rather, put it as part of the fourth bracha and include the malchuyot in it with the blowing of the shofar. So Rabbi Rambam for sure is pretty clear he's following Rabbi Akiva. Also the tool, Rabbi Yaakov, the son of the Rosh, in his Orach Chaim says, look at this statement, he's big. He doesn't always repeat this, but here, look what he's emphasizing. Minhag avoteinu Torah ve'en leshanot. The minhagim that we inherited from our forefathers is Torah, and we should not change it one bit. And then what is the minhag? Omer, avot ugvot ukdushat Hashem. So far, ordinary Shmonesre. And then the fourth bracha, malchuyot, and he does add, v'cholel imahem kedushat hayom. So we're supposed to integrate malchuyot as part of kedushat hayom. Zichronot, shofarot, avodah, hoda'a, virkat kohanim. So both of these poskim, and I could have brought many, many others, they all follow the approach of Rabbi Akiva. Malchuyot is part of the fourth bracha of kedushat hayom, of ata b'chartanu, and we blow the shofar as part of that bracha. So all we need to do now is check our sidurim and see what do we have in our current sidurim. What do we do nowadays? So I brought here the relevant sections that seem to show what the halakha that we're following. And I'm starting with the bracha of Kedushat Hayom, the fourth bracha of Shmoneh Esra. So how does it work? Think about this when we say the Shmoneh Esra on Chag. It's nice to remember the ideas we learned beforehand. So I hope you'll have that in mind. You should have other things in mind, but also that. So the tefillah goes as follows. Atah bechartanu mikol ha'amim, ahavta otanu v'ratzita banu, v'romamtanu mikol ha'leshonot v'kidashtanu v'mitzvotecha. I'm saving you the chazanut now. I'm not singing it. That will save for a few days from now. So, and surely it could take a little longer. Atah bechartanu mikol ha'amim, ahavta otanu v'ratzita banu, v'romamtanu mikol ha'leshonot v'kidashtanu v'mitzvotecha. That's the ordinary way that we start Kedushat Hayom, like in any Yom Tov, not just on Rosh Hashanah. So that is Kedushat Hayom, Yom HaZikaron, Yom Tu'ah, Mikra Kodesh. So that's the Kedushat Hayom part. And it goes on a little bit, I skipped here. And then in the middle of the same bracha, we shift to Malchuyot. And we start saying, "Aleinu leshabeach l'adon akol atet gedula liyotzer bereshit shelo asanu kegoyei haaretzot velo samanu kemishpachot ha'adama." I skipped again. "Ki hamalchut shelcha hi ulolmei hatimloch bekavod." And from here on, we start malchuyot. "Kakatuv betoratecha," and we're going to bring a bunch of psukim from the Torah. "Uvdivrei kodshecha katuv lemor," so we're going to bring a bunch of psukim from the ketuvim. "Al yedei avadecha nevi'im katuv lemor," a bunch of verses from the Nevi'im. We'll end up with another verse from the Torah. And then how does the Chatima, the ending of the Bracha, go? Eloheinu v'lo avoteinu, meloch al kol ha'olam kulo b'chvodecha. So again, we start with the Malchuyot, but we end with a combination of the two. Baruch ata Hashem, melech al kol ha'aretz. So that's the Malchuyot element. Mekadesh Yisrael v'yom ha'zikaron. So it's Malchuyot with the idea of Kedushat Hayom. So all indications seem to show that we follow the approach of Rabbi Akiva. However, it's not as simple. Otherwise, I wouldn't need to talk about this. It's not as simple because there's an additional bracha that comes before that I was avoiding. I didn't address so far. Now I'm going to talk about it briefly. And that's the bracha that we say as Kedushat Hashem. So this is the way Kedushat Hashem looks. The third bracha of Shmoneh Esrei. It goes like this. Ata kadosh v'shimcha kadosh v'kdoshim v'chol yom yaleluch ha'sela. Now, if this was an ordinary Shmoneh Esrei, of an everyday Shmoneh Esrei, we would just end up by saying, Ata kadosh v'shimcha kadosh v'kdoshim v'chol yom yaleluch ha'sela. We would end. Baruch ata Hashem, and Ha'el HaKadosh, or maybe you say HaMelech HaKadosh if it's the Aseret Yemei Teshuva. However, we have a very long passage that kind of disrupts the whole idea in the middle. It starts by saying, Uvchen, Ten Pachtecha Hashem Elokeinu al Kol Ma'asecha. So you're supposed to exhibit your, or lead to people to fear you. I'm sure you're familiar with this text. We go on. Uvchen, Ten Kavod Hashem Le'amecha. So it starts by talking about maybe the entire universe, then it talks about more specifically about your nation. Ten Kavod Hashem Le'amecha. Uvchen Tzadikim Yiru V'Yismachu. Talking about the righteous people. And finally, ותמלוך אתה השם לבדיך על כל מעשיך, בהר ציון משכן כבודך, ובירושלים עיר קודשך, ככתוב בדברי קודשך, ימלוך השם לעולם אלוהיך ציון לדור ודור, הללויה. קדוש אתה ונורא שמך ואין אלוה מבלדיך, ככתוב ויקבע השם צבאות המשפט, והאל הקדוש נקדש מצדקה, ברוך אתה השם המלך הקדוש. And the question I want to ask you is, where did this come from? Why do we say this entire passage as part of our Kedusha Hashem, as part of the third bracha? What is it doing here? Our third bracha seems should have been a regular bracha. We're including the malchuyot in the fourth bracha, not in the third bracha. So what is it doing here? Medieval scholars were actually a little bit perplexed by this text, and they come up with a very interesting insight or idea that this is, in a way, trying to correspond. The three uvchens, the three passages here, are supposed to correspond to the malchuyot, zichonot, and shofarot. One of them, Sefer Kolbo, one of the, I think, 13th, 14th century Sefer Minagim, says, Ve'inyan, the idea of Ele HaShlusha Uvchen, so the essence of these three Uvchen, She'omer B'Kdushat Hashem, that one recites as part of Kdushat Hashem, of the third bracha, Inyanam Malchuyot Zichonot V'Shofarot. They're supposed to correspond to the Malchuyot Zichonot and Shofarot. And he's trying to show that each one of the passages of the Uvchen connects in one way or another to one of those themes, meaning the text of Uvchen Ten Pachtecha is supposed to connect to Malchuyot. Ten Kavod Hashem Le'amecha is supposed to connect somehow to Zichronot. And Tzadikim Yiru V'Yismachu is supposed to connect to the Shofarot. He brings this idea, and many, many other medieval scholars repeat this in different forms and shapes, but more essentially the same idea. Now, I think this idea is far from convincing for two reasons. The first thing, why would we want to include Malchuyot, Zichronot, and Shofarot as part of our Kedushat Hashem? That's nobody's opinion, A. And B, their attempts to tie Uvchen Ten Pachtecha to Malchuyot, maybe that can somehow work. It's talking about fearing God. But Ten Kavod Hashem Le'amecha, how on earth does that connect to Zichronot? You really have to work hard to make that connection. Also, the Tzadikim Yiru V'Yismachu, how does that connect to Shofarot? You will see that they're coming up with all sorts of acrobatics, trying to make sense. Why is that really connected? But it's far from convincing. But I think there's a much more convincing approach that appears only in modern times, only 19th century scholarship and onwards. And according to the other opinion, perhaps what we're having here is actually some remnant, something that was left in the tefillah from the opinion of Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri. Perhaps this is the Malchuyot. Its entire piece really is a part of the Malchuyot prayer, because this is the theme of this whole passage. And this is the place that Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri felt Malchuyot should be included. If we follow this approach, we can find the word, we can explain a few things here, but the main thing we can explain, how did it make its way into our tefillah? And we can also explain why is the idea of malchut so dominant in this passage. V'timloch ata Hashem al kol ma'asecha, yimloch Hashem le'olam elohaich tzion. So the idea of malchut really belongs here. So therefore I'm suggesting, this is not my own idea, but I'm suggesting that perhaps we did not really rule out the approach of Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri. Something of that opinion was still left. Obviously, we'll still say the Malchuyot as part of Kedushat Hayom, but the original tefillah of Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri's Malchuyot might have been left in our Sidurim. I'll bring you one scholar who says that, and he's also trying to explain how that happened. He says as follows, his name is Gershon Herpens. He says, Lo zo bilvad, ela shekehal mitpalalim, the congregation, lo iskim levater al nus legamre al nusach hamalchuyot shel Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri. People just love the malchuyot of Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri. They wouldn't give it up so fast. And therefore, ve'imki, I'm skipping a little bit, ve'imki be'ofen rishmi, even though formally speaking, nifseka halacha ki Rabbi Akiva, even though we determined the halacha according to Rabbi Akiva, nevertheless, that we're supposed to say malchuyot as part of the fourth bracha, nevertheless, he says, lamrot zot, lo iskim ha'kahal ha'glili, the people in the Galilee were not willing to give up that malchuyot of Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri altogether, and therefore they still kept it as part of their shmonesre, as part of their bracha of Kedushat Hashem. Two small additions, and we have to rush to the last theme, or to the main, to the third theme of our discussion. Two interesting things. First, you might ask me then, why do we say the prayer, the text of Uvchen Ten Pachtecha, not just in Musaf? Why do we say it in Arvit and in Shacharit and Mincha? If it's Malchuyot, we don't say Malchuyot as part of all prayers. We're supposed to say it only in the Musaf prayer. So the answer is that it's not simple. There are many Rishonim, many medieval scholars who felt that one is supposed to say Malchuyot, Zichonot, Shofarot in all four prayers of Rosh Hashanah. Shacharit, Mincha, Arvit, Shacharit, Mincha, and Musaf. This idea is not unheard of. It actually appears in the words of different scholars from Provence and other places. So this could be part of the reason for this. Another issue we need to address is how did it make its way into Yom Kippur? But that is already more difficult to explain. And there are ideas scholars suggested, but that's already going to be a bit more complicated for now. One more thing we can refer to at this point. If this is indeed part of the Malchuyot, I think it explains beautifully the decision of the composer of this tefillah to start with the word Uvchen. Uvchen ten pachdecha, Uvchen ten kavod, Uvchen tzadikim yiru v'yismachu. Why does he choose this word Uvchen? It's not a common word, certainly not in tefillot. But if you recall, the word Uvchen appears in the Bible twice. One of them is in the Megillah of Esther, when Esther is about to enter Ahasuerus's palace, and she says, Uvchen avo el hamelech asher lo kedat, v'chasher avadeti avadeti. When she's about to approach the melech, she uses the word Uvchen. The Paitan who wrote this text chose the word Uvchen for this precise reason. I think he's trying to have us associate this word with the words of Esther. We're about to enter Hamelech, hoping that it's going to be Kedat, but we might be Shelo Kedat. So this is something about the fourth bracha of the third bracha of Shmonesre, and the possibility that it also kept that it's a remnant of the Malchuyot of Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri. You still have a question you need to ask me then. In our Malchuyot, we're supposed to have 10 verses in each one. So where are the verses? So the answer is that it's only Rabbi Akiva who felt that we need so many verses. Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri actually was happy with a smaller number of verses as part of his Malchuyot. This will bring us to the next theme. The Mishnah goes on and says as follows. En pochatin me'asara Malchuyot, me'asara zichronot, me'asara shofarot. So you're supposed to have 10 verses for the Malchuyot, 10 verses for the zichronot, and 10 verses for the shofarot. That's the approach of Tanakama, of the anonymous Tana here. Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri says, Im amar shalosh shalosh mikulan yatsa. So in Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri says, if he says 3 from each, he has fulfilled his obligation. We're not going to do this now, but if you look back in the bracha of Kedushat Hashem, of our Malchuyot, you will see that you can find at least 2 verses there. And there is a way that you might even locate a 3rd verse. And if that's the case, maybe even the verses are part of that bracha. You should look back into the tefillah when you do the tefillot. You can also look for those verses. 2 of them are explicit, and 1 of them might be hiding there as well. But now we're going to focus on the third theme, and that is the order of the verses that we say in our Malchuyot, Zichronot v'Shofarot. What does the Mishnah say? The Mishnah says as follows. Matchil, after it tells us the number of verses that you're supposed to recite, and I skipped a little one more sentence in the Mishnah, then the Mishnah says, Matchil b'Torah, u'mashlim b'Navi. You're supposed to begin, he begins with verses from the Torah, and he concludes with verses from the prophets. That's what the Mishnah says. Matchil b'Torah, u'mashlim b'Navi. Rashi explains, the way most commentators explain as well, Matchil b'Torah u'mashlim b'Navi means you're supposed to start with three verses from the Torah and with three verses from the Nevi'im, from the prophets, v'aktuvim b'intayim, and the writings are supposed to be found right in the middle. And then eventually we also add with one extra verse from the Torah, which is a separate sugya that we're not going to address now. But the order, the basic order of the main, of the big, the large number of sukim is matchil b'Torah. You start with three verses from the Torah. You end with three verses from the Nevi'im, from the prophets, and three verses in the middle are supposed to be from the Ketuvim. And the obvious question is, why? Why on earth will we want to do such an awkward way of organizing the verses? Wouldn't that make more sense if we just follow the regular order of Torah, Nevi'im, and Ketuvim? Torah, prophets, and writings. Why go out of order? Why are we using the Ketuvim before we say the Nevi'im? This is not my own question, obviously. This is a very, very ancient question that scholars were dealing with for over 1,000 years. And there are many, many attempts to solve this problem, this dilemma. And I'm gonna bring you at least two traditional interpretations, and then I'll come up with a scholarly insight. So what did traditional Mefarshim have to say about this? So we'll bring two solutions. We'll start with number four, we'll go back to number three. So Tosfot, on that sugya in Masechet Rosh Hashanah, suggests, he says as follows, Matchil b'Torah, u'mesayem b'Navi, and he says, Mishum dekrai de tihilim mishle ve'iyov kadmu la'nevi'im. Meaning, since the verses of Psalms, Proverbs, and Job were composed before the time of the prophets. So what Tosfot is trying to say, perhaps there is some logic for the decision to start with the Ketuvim before the Nevi'im. Maybe it has some historical foundations. The order of our Tanakh is not really a chronological order, because some of the Nevi'im actually were written after the writings, after the Ketuvim. Specifically, this is true when it comes to Sefer Tehillim. Most of the verses that we say in Malchuyot, Zichronot, and Shofarot come from Sefer Tehillim. And from a historical perspective, they were composed before Isaiah and Yirmiyah and all these books, before many of the prophets. So Tosfot's idea was, maybe our Mishnah, maybe our the Nusach of our Tefillah is following the historical order of the Psukim rather than the way that they were canonized in our Tanakhim. It's an interesting answer, but it's a little bit hard, not as convincing. I mean, if we're so accustomed to the idea of Torah, Nevi'im, Ketuvim, why suddenly here think about it from a historical perspective and try to follow the historical order? Why? The chronological order. Doesn't really make sense. The Ritva, Rabbi Yom Tov Alashvili, so he comes up with a different explanation, more from the theological realm, and he says, Vegan, mipnei she'en choshvim kdusha gdola b'ktuvim, וכדי שלא יזלזלו בקדושתן, ולהראות שכולם ברוח הקודש תקנו לעומרם תחילה. He's coming with a whole different type of explanation. His theory is the Tana, and also our Sidurim, chose, the author of this tefillah chose to say the writings before the prophets due to the fact that people didn't give enough respect to the Ketuvim. People think prophecies about the future, that's something that has to involve divine inspiration. But maybe just the writings are just words of wisdom. Maybe this is just human ideas. Maybe it's not something that is divine. So the tefillah is bringing the verses from the Ketuvim before the ones of the Nevi'im so that people should not mistreat the Ketuvim. People should treat them with a high degree of texts that were composed by Ruach HaKodesh. They were divinely inspired. So this is the idea of the Ritva. And I could have gone on and on and on and bring many, many other attempts to solve this problem. However, the solution might be, because again, it's a matter of debate, but the solution might be a little bit much more simple. However, also in a sense, a radical attempt to solve the problem. And the question I want to ask you is, how many parts does the Bible have? We're used to thinking that we have three parts, Torah, Nevi'im, and Ketuvim. But this is not necessarily the way that it always, that the Tanakh was actually, was that the books were divided from the very beginning. There are many, many indications that at least at some stage in history, people just made one distinction, not three categories, but rather two. It was Torah and everything else, and the Nevi'im. And the Nevi'im might have included even part of the Ketuvim, but they were not classified as a separate category. There was just Torah and Nevi'im. And you can find many, many proofs for this. We'll start with two proofs from the Second Temple literature, from the Book of Maccabees that I'm sure you're familiar with, part of the Apographa and Pseudepigrapha. So these books talk about the Tanakh in a few places. I shouldn't be saying Tanakh. They talk about Bible or biblical compositions, and they sort them into two groups, Torah and Nevi'im. There's no Ketuvim there. Here are examples for this. The first one is from Maccabees 4, number 18. This is the story of Hana and her seven sons, if you remember in the Chanukah context. And it talks, so the mother is teaching, speaking to her kids before they're about to be killed. And she's telling them stories about their father. She says, among other stuff, I'm not translating this to English, here, Be'odenu chag, when your father was still alive, Haya melamed etchem et haTorah ve'et haNevi'im. He used to teach you the Torah and the Nevi'im. And it specifies, it goes into details, and it tells us what stories did the father teach the kids when he refers to Torah and Nevi'im. And it actually refers to texts that are part of our current Ketuvim, which might indicate that at some stage in history, there was just two categories, Torah and Nevi'im. Also in another place in the Book of Maccabees, obviously each book was a separate story, but this is with regards to Yehuda Maccabee trying to comfort his soldiers. So it says there, the last verse in the second passage, Uvenachamotam, when he used to comfort his people, Min haTorah u'min haNevi'im, from the Torah and from the Nevi'im. Even in Chazal, even in rabbinic literature, you can find places where the Chazal are referring only to Torah and Nevi'im. One example is in the Halachot of Bava Metzia, when the Mishnah discusses people, if somebody finds a book and he needs to know how to treat the book, the Mishnah over there refers to Torah and to Nevi'im, or in the Tanaitic sources, they refer to Torah and to Nevi'im. In Bava Batra, when they talk about the obligations of the community, which books they're supposed to purchase for the community, it talks about Torah and Nevi'im. And the Ketuvim are not mentioned as a separate corpus. Whether it's because they were still not fully included or because they just didn't classify them as two separate groups. If this is the case, I think we might come up with a much more simple, a simpler solution to our problem. We were asking, what does it mean when the Mishnah says "Matchil baTorah u'mashlim baNavi"? And we were assuming that Navi stands in contrast to Ketuvim. So we have Torah at the beginning, Nevi'im at the end, and what's in the middle. So we were assuming it's the Ketuvim that come up in the middle, and then we're starting to raise all these questions. But perhaps what the Mishnah was just meant to say, you start with the Torah, "Matchil baTorah u'mashlim baNavi," meaning, and you conclude with the rest of the Bible. It's not trying to say Nevi'im or Navi in contrast to Ketuvim. Navi is just a contrast to the Torah. It doesn't talk about a three-part Malchuyot, Zichonot, V'Shofarot. It's talking about, it doesn't get into the details. How are you supposed to sort verses here? Are you supposed to do it 3-3-3 or 5-5? It doesn't give us all of this information. It just says you're supposed to open up with verses from the Torah and conclude from verses from the rest of the Bible. If this is indeed the meaning, so I think the Mishnah makes much more sense, and we don't have to assume that we're going out of any order. This is following the order of the Tanakh. this is not my own idea. Again, you can find it in the 19th and 20th century scholarship. This is from one of Finkelstein's article in the footnote. He says, "Ha-halakha shelefi ha-seder ha-ktubim b'malchuyot zichonot v'shafarot." The halakha that says that the order of the verses of malchuyot zichonot v'shafarot matchil b'torah u'mesayim b'navi. When Mishnah is referring to the fact, is addressing the fact you're supposed to start with the Torah and conclude with the Navi, yesoda, it's rooted, lefi aniyut dati, according to his humble opinion, ba'uvda zo, shebizman kadum hayu rak shnei suchot. There were only two parts to the Bible back then, and the verses that we have in our Malchuyot Zichonot HaShafarot were supposed to address both. And it never said anything about the precise order of the verses that we're supposed to take from the remaining part of the Bible, the part that comes after the Torah. If this is the case, so if we were now to write the brachot, to choose the verses and to sort the verses from Malchuyot Zichonot HaShafarot, we wouldn't even have to go out of the way. We could probably start with the Torah and go by order, bring verses from the Nevi'im and bring finally verses from the Ketuvim. We don't have to switch the order because the Mishnah never meant to say that. Indeed, this is a big discovery, but it's not the only document, but indeed, in the Gniza in Cairo, such piyutim of zichonot, malchuyot zichonot v'shafarot were found, in which the order of the psukim is Torah, Nevi'im, and Ketuvim. It's not out of order. It follows the ordinary order of psukim. We're not going to read the piyut part here. It's a different formulation for the entire bracha of Malchuyot Zichonot HaShafarot. The only thing we're interested in is the words that come up after each one. So you have a part for the piyut, and then it says, you see the first section ends with the words, Kakatuv betoratecha. So you start with the verses from the Torah. That's the first section. Kakatuv betorah, lo ibit aven b'yakov, ve'lo ra'a amal b'Yisrael. So we start with the verses from the Torah. Then, rather than bringing verses from the Ketuvim, the way we say, it says, Kakatuv al yedei nevi'echa, or al yad nevi'echa, it goes to the Nevi'im. And only at the end, Kakatuv bedivrei kodshecha, ki l'ashem amlucha u'moshe lo goyim v'chulei. So the order might have been the regular, the routine order of Torah, Nevi'im, Ketuvim. It was not necessarily an attempt of the Mishnah to make things more weird or go out of the way. It might have been an attempt to talk about Torah in contrast to the rest of the Bible. I think it's a very simple solution. It's more complicated than that. You have to check, if you want to do the full job, you have to look in the Tosefta. The Tosefta does add some more information because it mentions the Ketuvim, but it still goes by the right order, Torah, Nevi'im, Ketuvim. And I think this is part of the same, it goes along with this theory, with a little bit of refinement that we need to make there. But that basic idea is that there were two parts, Torah and everything else. And the Mishnah did not mean to violate the order of the psukim the way that they're in our current Tanakhim. So that was the third theme. So far, we spoke about the origin of the tefillah. We were trying to emphasize that the Malchuyot might be a later idea that was added on and became an essential part of our Rosh Hashanah, but it's not necessarily the original part of the Shmoneh Esrei of the day. We spoke about the way that the brachot were included in our tefillah, and we saw that the shaky status of Malchuyot is still evident in the way and that was the reason maybe that the Tanaim were arguing about the place where you're supposed to install that part of the Shmoneh Esrei. And we just love them both versions of Malchuyot, so we maybe still say both the Malchuyot of Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri and of Rabbi Akiva. So it might have started as a shaky status bracha, but it ended up being recited twice, both in Kedushat Hashem and in Kedushat Hayom. We moved on and we spoke about the verses and we were asking why go out of order, and scholars provided ideas. Why is it really the proper order of the brachot? Because the Mishnah never meant to violate the routine or the usual order. We'll just end up with something about the meaning of the brachot. It won't be just about scholarship, but also something more meaningful. I think that there's something very interesting in the way that the brachot are formulated, and it leaves one question a little bit ambiguous. It's very evident in the case of shofarot, but also in zichronot, and to a certain extent, also with regards to malchuyot. We say Sofarot is about blowing the shofar. Zichronot is about remembering, and Malchuyot is about appointing or anointing a king. But who is the subject of this? Who is the person who is supposed to blow the shofar, and who's the person, what's the entity that is supposed to listen? Who is the person or entity that is supposed to doing this remembering thing? And also, who is the person who's responsible for doing this hamlacha of HaKadosh Baruch Hu? I think that the brachot are giving us a very interesting mixture of formulations. The bracha of shofarot, like many brachot, if you remember for the previous year, starts with the word ata. Like most of the brachot, we usually start with the word ata. And the impression you get at the beginning of the bracha is that the shofarot, the blowing of the shofar, is something that God is supposed to do. It starts by saying, ata nigleta be'anan kvodecha al'am kodshecha ledaber imam. Uvekol shofar, I'm skipping, so this is alluding to the event of Aseret HaDivrot. Uvekol shofar alehem ofata. So the HaKadosh Baruch Hu was the one who was blowing the shofar at the beginning. Also, later on in the bracha, it's referring to the future. Eloheinu ve'elohe avoteinu teka b'shofar gadol l'chevuteinu. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu is the one who's supposed to do the blowing of the shofar, both in the past and in the future. However, in between, or as part of that same bracha, we suddenly also say that we have a role in this blowing business. The Mishnah says, the bracha says at the very end, the final verse that is quoted from the Torah reads, at the end of the bracha, v'sham nase lefanecha et korbonot chovotenu kemetzuve aleinu betoratecha, and it says, uviyom simchatchem uvimoadechem uvrashei chodeshechem, utka'atem b'chatzotzrot. So we're supposed to be blowing the shofar. And also at the chatima of the bracha, suddenly HaKadosh Baruch Hu, who was so far the one who was blowing the shofar, becomes the person, or the one who's supposed to hear the shofar. Ki ata shomea kol shofar, umazin kol tru'a ve'en dome lecha. Baruch ata Hashem shomea kol tru'at amo Yisrael berachamim. Suddenly we become the ones who blow the shofar, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu is the one who listens. I think it's fascinating, but it's not just in the shofarot. It's also a little bit hinted. I think it's also found in the zichronot one. Look in the zichronot. Again, the obvious. Ata zocher ma'ase olam ufoket kol yitzurei kedem. And I'm skipping. Ata zocher et kol ha'mif'al v'gam kol ha'yetzur lo nikhad mimecha. And also at the chatima. Zochreinu b'zichron tov lefanecha. So it's all about God remembering us. You remember everything, and we pray that also in the future, you'll remember us in a positive light. Ki zocher kol hanishkachot ata me'olam. But in between, in the middle of the zichronot, there's a fascinating verse that comes up. It says, and it seems like it doesn't really belong, but it says, you remember everything. Ashrei ish shelo ishkachecha. So we praise every human being who doesn't forget God. Suddenly, we are the ones who are supposed to remember. And God is the one who's being remembered. But we're doing the active role of remembering things. And I think you can also find similar ideas in Malchuyot. In Malchuyot, I think it's a little bit more tricky, because if we are supposed, these two things go together. If we pray to have God become the king, in a sense, that is also him being the king. So we can't really separate between these two things. And I think this is sending a very important message for Yamim Noraim in general. Yamim Noraim is not about a role of that. It's not about HaKadosh Baruch Hu, or it's not, and it's not just about us. It's in a sense a dialogue or a connection between the two parties that are involved. HaKadosh Baruch Hu zocher otanu letova, when we remember him. HaKadosh Baruch Hu itka b'shofar gadol, if we remember to do our duties. And the same thing, I think, also goes to Yom Kippur. Forgiving, God's willing to forgive for us our sins involves us being able to forgive sins that people have committed to us. So it's a mutual process. It's not just begging or asking God to listen to our and to fulfill what we want, but it also involves a very important role that we have in this process. So on this note, I want to conclude. It's exactly 7:30 now, Israel time. So I want to conclude and wish you all Shana Tova, and Mezrat Hashem, our wishes will become true, and that's all.
Amen. Toda rabba, shana tova.
Zella, I saw you had a question come up in the chat during class. Is it still relevant? It
Wait
is,
a minute.
feel free to ask.
The Uwe Haynes was two other times. One was in Esther, and where's
I think
the
there's
other
one?
One?
I think the other one is in Eov.
Eov.
I don't know. The context there is not really helping us, as far as
okay.
I can tell. But the
Okay.
Esther one is good enough, no?
Yes, yes. Excellent. Thank you.
I thought it was fascinating when I heard this.
This really
you know,
great.
All these things, these tiny nuances, fill the tefillah with so much more meaning.
Yes.
Yes.
One word, but it suddenly here is so different.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Shuv, tada rabba. Okay. Shalom, shalom.
Question?
Yes.
Is there, was Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri in the Galil that the assumption was it was his people that were reluctant to give it up?
That's what this scholar writes. I'm not sure if the only way you need, you don't have to formulate it that way. I think you could say in tefillah in general, there's a tendency that when there's a debate between two approaches, we say them both. It appears in many tefillot. Chazal say in a bunch of places, Nemrinu letravay, we shall say them both. It's in Kiddush Levana, we have something like that. In Bracha Negshamim, there's a bracha, we say Ela Odaot, Rova Odaot. There are a bunch of brachot where Chazal say, if there are two conflicting opinions, why not say both? So I think we can say, it doesn't have to be, you know, Galil versus Yuda. You can just say people felt, why omit one of the two if we can include them both? But I think it gives us a lot of, it makes more sense that you understand how this tefillah came up. That
Thank
it's not
you.
Just a text that came out of nowhere.
Right.
Thank
yeah.
you. Thank you.
Okay. Shana Tova.
Shana Tova.
Shana Tova, everyone. All right, enough of us. See everyone in our fall classes, and the class recording will be up on YouTube very soon.